gifts. All right, guys, come on in. Come on in.
Nah, it doesn't work like that.
We're just going to video whatever we're doing this afternoon. There's nothing major about what I want to achieve this afternoon, especially just trying to set some guidelines that I'd like us to follow as far as some technical competencies with the kids. Even though a lot of us actually have things in gameplay where we might be working within team environments, one of the things that was noted last year was some of the little technical things that should be fixed aren't getting fixed, and we're basically just allowing it to occur. So what we want to try and do tonight is just highlight them, we'll reinforce it when we go back inside, and then when we get back inside as well, we just want to look at the sports session planner to give you a bit of an idea on the individual session plans. Last time we got together, we looked at what we're doing as far as the periodization is concerned. Tonight I want to look at the actual individual training session, see if we can get a little bit of a starting point for everyone, if that's all right. All right. So what we're going to get you to do is just quickly, Mateo, do you want to just head out there for a sec? Johnny, give us that ball for a moment. I'm just going to play a couple of balls, and all I want you to do is just receive it for me. Just whatever you're comfortable with. Yeah, come on, it's fine. Actually, Nick, you can serve if you will. Here, leave it. Get another one.
Any danger?
And stop there. Okay. Not too much of an issue with you guys. What I'm going to say, though, is when we're working with kids, just give the ball to Mateo for a sec. When we're working with young players, a lot of them have a tendency to be very much one-footed, and everything that they do is they use the same foot. All right? What I'm going to say to you is this. Players who are receiving things regularly using the outside of the foot, that's one of the competencies we need to change. I want players working really hard to receive the inside of the feet. And here's the reasons why. Hopefully the camera can see this. Mateo, just what you're receiving is the outside of your right, okay? Good lad, well done, gives it back. Same again, outside of the right. Good lad, gives it back. And turn left. Can't do it, can you? Alright? So if you use the inside of your foot, or if you use the outside of your foot, just quickly show us where you go.
Outside,
yeah. Don't care which foot, doesn't matter. If you use the outside of your foot, the ball gets outside your hips. Alright? Unfortunately, and watch what Mateo does, when you get a turn, I just want you to dribble off this time, okay? Outside of the foot, turn, and away he goes. Stop there. Have a quick look at where the ball now is. What's your observation?
There's a long way from where
come
it started.
Come back in.
Long way from where it started.
Once he actually gets his turn in and away he goes, the ball ends up between his hips again. All right? So what I'm going to say to you is this. When we're working with the ball here, if players receive with the inside of the foot more often, and I want that to become a habit, okay? So if he receives the inside of the foot, I want you to turn and go away this time as well, Mateo. I don't care which way you go, it's up to you. Ball gets played. Inside of the foot, turns away, took two touches, gives the ball back. That's not what we're after either. First touch keeps the ball moving if you possibly can. But it's inside of the foot. Okay, and look, ball's already within his hips. Mm-hmm. Now that's important for things that we're doing with the players, all right? So we want to work really hard to ensure that out of habit, players are receiving with the insides of the feet. They get lazy, and they get lazy and go and use their preferred foot as an example. And everything is the outside of the foot. If they use the outside of the foot, they can't go in the opposite direction. If I play Mateo here, inside of the foot, turn right. Okay, come back. Not actually turn around, actually turn right. Okay, inside of the foot, turn right. Good lad, well done, give it back. Inside of your left foot, turn right. So with both feet, using the insides of the feet, he can go in both directions. Whereas if he uses the outside of his foot, outside or right, can't go left though, can you? So they're things that really are very important as far as the technical concepts we're looking at today. We want players to have more opportunities of making more decisions about what they do with the ball. I'm not going to say to you that it will always end up being like that. Because as an example, Nick, just go in there and hang off the back of him. Get in quickly. For example, if a defender's in there tight, it might be preferable. You've got to keep it. Just got to keep it. He might have to do things like that. But what we're saying in general play, we want to, as much as possible, to encourage players to receive using the insides of the feet so it becomes a habit. All right? From there, just come in there, Mateo, and face that way. That's the direction we're heading. Nicky, you can just drop out a little bit if you can. Right. All what you do now, just take your first touch, get forward. Excellent. That's fine. Just take a couple of steps. Back in we come. So what I'm going to ask players to do as often as they can, if your hips are facing forward, and I try and do this with players, I generally say feet and hips, because if your feet and hips are facing in a certain direction, that's where we're playing, okay? So if your feet and hips are facing forward, when you receive the ball, I want you to receive it with the furthest foot. Why?
So you're facing the way you're going to play.
Yeah.
The ball's rolling across you, so it's hard to take a good first touch with your new foot.
Absolutely. Go back to what we were doing before. We're still going to use the inside of your feet. This is the way we're going. But you're going to only use your nearest foot this time. Is that fair enough? Inside of your nearest foot. Stop there. Where's these hips facing?
Wrong way. Back towards us.
Back in this direction. So that's where the first touch is likely to be. So we want to try and ensure that players get into the habit as well. Anything that comes to them, can we start receiving things with the furthest foot? The other thing about that as well, Nick, just put him under pressure once the ball starts to come. And as it arrives, Mateo, just give him a little shimmy and see if he can let it come all the way across your body to go outside Nick. All I want you to do, Nick, is run to where the ball's going to be, where his feet is right at this moment. Is that fair enough? So if he lets things come across his body, you just brought it back in and got whacked. Let your first touch with the furthest foot, take it away. So you're actually trying to get beyond Nick if you can, okay? You ready? Push in there. Good lad, well done. And just that millisecond, that actually helps players make a little bit more decisions as well. All right, so anything coming to players, we want to encourage them to receive things with the furthest foot. Is that all right? Want to look at it the other way if we're actually going forward. Actually, we'll do it from here. Just go and mark him, Nick, and you can go give yourselves a little bit more distance. So hopefully you're in shot there. Just double check. As I said, there's no rocket science to any of this. Now imagine we're going towards the trees, that's where the goals are, okay? So if we're playing in that direction and Mateo ends up in line with the ball, your job is just to receive it and see if you can get past Nick. Is that fair enough? Ready to play? And we are live. Play. All right, well done. Stop there, relax. Now, so if you want the ball, you show me where you want it.
Yeah.
Play when you're ready. Okay, well done. Couple more. And stop there. Now, where's he facing though?
Backwards.
So, we're wanting players to receive and face where?
Forward.
Now, here's the biggest problem for us. Centre forwards, guys who play in central midfield, they're our biggest protagonists of stopping us and preventing us from actually playing the way we need to be playing. Because runs that they make, let's come towards me in the tend to be where their feet and hips face the ball and they come towards. All right? What I'm going to say to players is this. And I'd like us to see if we can get on the same type of terminologies if we can. Mateo, just get closer to Nick. Now, when you make a run where you want it, I want you to make a run where you get more in line with the ball. I'll show you what I mean. Start making a run out here. Just curve it. Don't go in a straight line. So if you keep going, if you kept going, at some stage, you're actually going to end up in line with the ball, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Okay? So we want players, instead of running to the ball, we want them to make runs where they get a little bit more in line with the ball. For two reasons. Firstly, it keeps that distance. Now, if they start running towards the ball, they get closer, it brings the defender closer. We're now dealing with the defender closer around the ball. If they start making runs where they start to try and get more in line with the ball, the player receiving it is now opposite the passer. So if I play him the ball now, is it easier for his hips to be facing forward?
Yes.
And that's what we're wanting. We actually want the player having the opportunity. I mean, you couldn't just zoom in on. Just go back and make the first run. So we get the first one where he comes towards the ball. And as you can see, feet and hips are facing this way. The run that he made before was a straight line. Just run straight in there, as you pointed. Again, his hips are still facing away from goal. Still can't face forward. But if he makes a run that gets more in line with the ball, or yeah, he opens up and bends out, there we go, we've got better chances of keeping it. Now, one of the things that you'll find, just keep the ball there, one of the things that players say to me all the time about these types of runs, and he's obviously used the outside of the furthest foot from the passer, they say the defender can actually get in there and have a bite. And here's all I'll say to that. Just get close, Nick. If you have to take your first touch can still be backwards as long as your hips are facing forward. And it then means your second touch can be forwards. So if you're in any doubt, you can't play forwards or you can't go beyond where the defender is, your first touch can still bring the ball back into areas where you can now still play forward. And that's important to us as well. So we want the players to understand that as a concept as well, if that's all right.
What do you do about where you're trying to teach the nine who wants to take every touch forward to actually come backwards and bring the midfield into the game as you're trying to progress up the pitch?
Are we talking tactically or technically?
Technically, because a lot of the time, some of them, they do it that there for every touch is forward and then they're turning the ball
over.
Well,
the thing is, it's the runs that they make first, Steve, that, like, if I look at some of the kids that are currently playing for us, who are tending to be some of the bigger, stronger, faster kids, they tend to still make runs towards the ball, get it and turn and face forward.
Right.
There's a difference between what they're currently doing and what the expectation is.
Yep.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yep. So we actually want them to be more aware of the runs that they're making to help. And I'm just going to say, do that same run, Bataya. I want players to start getting into the habit of getting opposite the passer, not in line with the passer. So if your feet and hips are facing him, then don't play him.
Yep.
Look at some whatever other options may be available. The other thing is, go back in the tap. And again, these are habits, habit-forming behaviours we're talking about. There is still opportunities where players come and show, and they'll receive. Stop there. Now, all I'm going to say to you is this. If you get into these environments where you can't play forwards, give it to somebody on your team who can. Just go there, Alex, for example. Yeah. Just go in there, Corey, if you can. Give the ball back here. So if you can't play forward, Mateo, if you make runs where you end up with your hips facing backwards, give the ball to anyone on your team who's facing forwards. Okay, and stop there. Now you're facing forward again. So not only that, just stay there. Not only that, we've now got an opportunity here to make a 2v1. So you've brought Alex into the game. You've got yourself now facing forward. The defender now has to deal with two of them. All right? So if you can't play the ball forward, give it to somebody who can. Now that might be the goalkeeper. If we're playing at the back or under pressure, instead of woofing it out off the field, it might just be more productive for us just to give it back into the goalkeeper and let him make a decision about what he does next. Because at the end of the day, if we can still continue to play rather than actually have the win possession back from a throw-in or lob something forward where we're actually going to have to deal with winning possession back while it's in the air, I'd rather keep it and try and play. All right, so we're going to try and encourage that as much as we possibly can as well. Any comments, thoughts?
No, that makes sense.
Cool. So getting opposite, hips facing forward, playing with the furthest foot, all basic competencies. They're all technically based. The problem is we get kids into environments where we're coaching them in teams and we let all that go out the window because we put up with what they're prepared to give us. And that's not good enough. Because if you want better performance out of the players, you've got to stamp on it and do it early. Stamp on it so we get the opportunity for them to have the playing behaviours that's going to help us build upon. Because if we can get players facing forwards more often, what can they do? They can play forward. Absolutely. All right? If we get players making runs where they might start central, but they end up opposite the passer, where you go, Mateo, open up. What does that now do for us as far as a team is concerned? Well, that now might mean I might
drive.
Be able to drive in there.
Yep.
Same again, we've now got a 2v1 again. So anything that you do as a player affects everybody else. So we just want to be sure that we're aware that the basic competencies that we're looking at here have a massive spin-off effect on how we actually perform as a team. All right? And that doesn't matter where you play. If you're the right back or the left back, and we play the ball to you, we're still looking for you to receive with the furthest foot. Because if you do that, you're facing forward. All right? Now, the other thing I'm just going to say on that is the intensity at which we do things has to be much better than what we're producing within training sessions. we as coaches set the bar higher than what the players can probably get to, and they might fall below it, and that's fine. But if we don't set it high enough, if we just accept what they're prepared to give, that's the performance level you're going to get, whether it's out on the park or it's on the training paddock. All right? Now, the other thing is this. Mateo, have the ball face Nick. Nick, I'll get you to defend the goals that side. So Mateo's going that way, basically. All right? Just keep that in shot if you can of me. Just a little 1v1. Give the ball to Nick. Let him give it back to you, Mateo, and then we're live. Just defend to about where the ball is, Nick. There we go. Okay, well done. Relax. Come do it again. Stop there. Well done. Last one. That's the best one. And I want everyone to come in for a second and tell me why it was the best one. It wasn't because Mateo finally got past him.
You got my hips square.
Bang on. Got your hips square, but he got your square. Give the ball for a sec. So he worked hard, because you defend from side on as you do.
Yeah.
He worked hard to get into this situation where now the ball ends up central, and if he now takes you on, he's only beating one leg.
Yeah.
Now, invariably, sometimes that's actually your standing leg that you're trying to pivot on.
Yeah.
But if he goes from here, for where he's outside your hips, and tries to beat you where he beats both legs,
yeah,
you've got a better chance of winning it. Yeah. All right? So we want players to recognize, when they're engaged in little 1v1 battles with defenders, can they firstly get their hips to line up with the opposition, and then when they're looking to get past, can they attack and beat only one leg? Because if you've got to beat two legs, you know, if I'm outside here and Nick goes there, that takes more time to start with. Mm-hmm. And secondly, it gives me an opportunity to take a step and adjust. The ones that have been most successful, and the one that you got in there was exactly that. You got him squared up and went bang, I'm going to go past that one leg. Alright? They're little things, all of them. They're really minuscule when it comes to the game. But if we can fix these little areas up, we'll get better performance out of players. And that's what we want. Alrighty. Okay, let's head back inside so we can have a discussion. Actually, can we grab one? I know one thing I did forget to do. I wanted to actually just show a little passing practice. We'll do that early in the year. There's a couple little things I'd like us to do fairly regularly for a number of reasons. Firstly, it helps reinforce those type of player actions. All right. Secondly, it's non-prescriptive, and by that I mean player one doesn't play player two, plays player three, although it does start off like that initially, but it gets into free play quite soon. And again, it just reinforces those same things that we've looked at. So just having a quick look there, on first touches, we want to receive with the insides of the feet out of habit. All right, we want the players to work that way. What I'm saying to you guys as coaches is, don't let players take liberties. If they're getting lazy about having to take a step to allow themselves to get their hips facing forward, our job is to come in and try and correct that. Because if we allow it to happen, it's going to be with them for the rest of the year. If you allow the performance to actually continue as it is, it'll stall a lot of the things that we still want to work on.
For the guys who haven't done a lot of SAP, the biggest habit is they won't move their feet. They'll take it on the wrong foot rather than just the feet.
Yeah, and a lot of that's also down to the fact that they're predominant on one foot anyway. I know my actual playing career is a long, long time ago, but a number of years ago I was playing in an over 35s tournament and they asked me to go and play left midfield. And at half time when I came in, the guy who was looking after the side said, are you left footed? I said, no, why? He says, well, every time the ball comes here, you seem to use your left foot.
Yeah.
I said, it's a habit. I said, if I receive with the inside of my left foot, I'm facing forward, then means I can play forward. And so even at that level, players recognise those types of things. So, feet and hips are important to be facing forward. We want to try and give them a reference point. The goals don't move. So if you want to try and ensure that players are doing the right thing, give them a reference point. Are your feet and hips facing the goal? All right? That gives them something to work towards. Receiving the ball with the furthest foot from the passer or where it comes from. in what we were doing there, I was actually playing things slightly backwards to you as such, but it's no different if he's playing in front of the ball. So the same things apply. Furthest foot gives us a little bit more time to be doing things. With the first touch, and this is where you, Matteo, your first couple of touches there was a stop and then go. Stop, go, stop, go. I want players to get into the habit that their first touches keep the ball moving. So that means they've actually got to recognise, as the ball's arriving, what they're going to do next. Because if we don't, we're actually reducing the amount, they're not actually making a decision until the ball is here.
Too late.
Too late by then. That 1 second in time is enough for a player to take 5 steps. That means a defender can be on top of you. Whereas if the ball's travelling and you're assessing what's in there so you can take your first touches, you'll get out of trouble a little bit easier. And again, preferably forwards. On the dribbling side of things, one thing I didn't talk to you about there was changing feet. I just want you to be aware of what that is. If you're dribbling in a game and you're looking at one particular part of the park, if you move the ball from one foot to the other, it changes your hips, so you're actually looking at a different picture. So if I start running into traffic and suddenly I go, I'm just going to change feet here and bring it in there, my hips are going to allow me to actually view something different, so the picture's going to be totally different. So when you hear me talking about changing feet, that's what I mean. So I'd like players to be aware that we don't just run into trouble. If we're trying to get out of trouble, just change feet. Have a look at a different picture. Get the hips moved so they go somewhere different. Crossovers and changeovers is another thing. If you're confronted by a defender and you're actually running with the ball towards one of your teammates, what's wrong with actually offloading it to him and he takes off and you're still going forward? So allowing players to recognise those types of opportunities when they present themselves as well. Dribbling isn't just about you as the player trying to take everyone on. It's about trying to get players brought together so we can exploit them outside. So if we have little changeovers and Matteo and I, as soon as our hips start to line up, we might decide to run at each other. He might come in, I might not give it to him, I might continue on. But what does that actually do to the defenders themselves?
Nothing.
Brings them together to start. If you can get defenders somewhere together, centrally, then there's spaces either side that you can exploit. So I want you to be aware of those also. And as I just identified there, beat one leg of an opponent. Because if they recognise they're only beating one leg, we've got better chances of getting by. On passing, firm accurate passing abilities are 10 to 15 metres. At this level, it shouldn't be any issue, even with our SAP kids. 10 to 15 metre passes is just bread and butter stuff. All right? The problem is, we allow them to underpass, underweight things as it goes to each other. They need to fire it in, so players can actually deal with the ball on their first touch. I used to work with the QAS girls, they whack things at each other. It's up to the player receiving it to deal with it. So they work on their first touch more often. So we want to make sure that that becomes the bread and butter for all of our sides. 10, 15 metres, we never give it away. Things that we're playing in there, they're getting in there firm. Because if we knock underweighted passes, defenders have a habit of getting in front and going and winning it. And we want to avoid those types of things from occurring. Are we able to play between defenders? So, John, you and Steve are there. Corey's just beyond. I might be able to play between defenders to turn them around. Anything that turns a defender around is good for your team. Because it means they're chasing back towards goal. We said that one out there. If you can't play the ball forward, give it to someone who can. And again, it's just something I want to become as a habit. Because players have this tendency. I won't mention names. We have several players in the club who receive the ball. They're central, receive the ball, feet and hips going that way. They take 15 touches, then decide to go and wonder why they get whacked. Whereas if it had just gone, here you go, Corey, and then face forward again, suddenly the defender's now faced with a different decision. I'm facing forward. You've got the opportunity of playing forward because you're facing forward. There's so many more decisions for us without getting involved in battles. We play against lots of teams who are bigger, stronger, faster. They're big physical specimens. Why do we want to give them the opportunity of giving you a whacking? Because you're wanting to hang on to the ball for 8 or 10 touches before you release it. So if you can't play it forward, just give it to someone who can. Wall passes, 1-2s. Again, gets back to the passing abilities over 10 to 15 metres, you know, where we actually get engaged by a defender, I might play into Matteo and I quickly go to get the return pass by going past the defender. These are things that should come up in your training sessions every session.
Now, if you're working on receiving, passing is still part of it. Because you're not going to receive the ball unless someone passes. If they're not going to give firm enough passes, the receiving is going to be crap. So it's important that we try and concentrate on those. Now, you'll get all these notes anyway, but I mean, they're things that we've just brought up, and they're just little technical competencies. One thing I'm going to ask you guys, when you selected players for your teams, what did you look for? What made your decision you were going to pick a particular player?
Technical, physical.
Okay. There's a couple of broad comments. What technical, physical?
They had a first touch. Their body shape was right when they were receiving the ball. That kind of stuff.
Yeah. But it's funny, when you're looking at a group of players, you might look at 30 players. If we were all just searching, we're all coaches and we have a board with everyone's names on, and we're looking at about 30 or 40 players, all of us will have about 10 of the same names. Because good players stand out. But what I want you to think about is, why do they stand out? What is the reason that those players stand out? What do they do technically? What do they do physically? What do they do tactically? What decisions do they make? And do you cognitively recognize that while they're playing? Because there's going to come a stage where we're going to need to start looking and scrutinizing players more and more, and it'll come down to the wires of what they do technically. And little things like this are top of the list for me. If players are consistently receiving the ball with the insides of the feet and facing forward, I'm thinking, I can work with that. If they're consistently taking first touches in the spaces away and keeping away from danger, I'm thinking I can use that. All right? The last thing for me is the intensity of how the players actually perform. Now, some of that's our fault. Some of us just allow them to go through the motions. All right? What I want us to try and do next year is see if we can raise the bar. Look, that's the end result of what we want, okay, as far as proficiency is concerned. However, I will substitute any of that if we can get the intensity levels up. Because what you'll find is their technical ability will catch up. Right? If you allow them to do things at laborious rates, where it's comfortable for them, that's what you'll get, and that will be the end product when they play. Everyone keeps saying to me some of our players aren't fit enough. The only reason they're not fit enough, they don't work hard enough when we've got them. And I don't mean by running them around the park. That's not going to make them a better footballer. It's going to make them a better athlete. But if we can work high intensity on technical aspects of the game, you're going to find that the result at the end of it is going to be a better equipped player who can do things faster at pace and comfortably, because they'll deal with it. I used to have players when I worked in Far North Queensland and North Queensland. I used to have players back, and that was back in the days when we had two teams in the National League with Brisbane Lions and Brisbane City. And we had guys come down from country Queensland who were, in that region, really good players. But they'd come to me before they went, being the regional coaching and development manager, and they'd ask for some advice. And I said to them, look, it's going to take you 10 weeks just to deal with the changing of pace, just to deal with the speed of how they perform down there, because you can do things here comfortably. And there was a guy called Peter Herney, who I really rated as a footballer. He came down to play for Lions. And 10 weeks to the day it was before he actually made his first team debut. And when he came back to Townsville, he actually said exactly that. He said, you were right on the money. He said, got down there, I was chasing shadows for 3 weeks. He said, but once I started getting used to that pace and was able to compete, then I started grinding my way in, and before too long, I was actually matching it. So that's what we want from players.
I mean, you remember when Merrick went down to Central Coast Mariners,
yep.
He had exactly the same experience. He said that everyone was just that little bit
yep.
quicker in terms of the game, the thought and the movement and everything else. And it took him, I think, the whole trial period of a month he was down there
oh, yeah.
to even get close.
When the Strikers were in the National League, they had a lad called Steve Fitzsimmons played for them. Fitzsimmons is a Gold Coast lad. He is as quick as lightning, and I mean really quick. And I used to have to go in on behalf of Football Queensland and run a AFC C license course for them. Well, back then it was the old level two. And we're in these little tight area practices where we play a short, and I jumped in, and I've nutmegged Fitzsimmons 3 times in this practice. And he said, I can't believe you did that. I said, Steve, you don't realise how slow I am. Because he was so quick and reactive, he's thinking everybody else does that. And funnily enough, when you play against someone who's a little bit slower, you have to adjust to that as well.
Yeah, their time is off.
Yeah, absolutely. So I've nutmegged him three times. I didn't mean to. I was actually just trying to get the ball bounced off machines. Right. Okay. So everyone comfortable with that?
Yeah.
Does that help a little bit, or is it things that you may not have seen before? If it's not something you've seen before, excellent. If it's something you've seen before, then we're on the same page. We need to just keep pushing forward. Now, getting back to our last session just quickly, I just want to see where we're at. Has anyone made any progress on your team periodization at all? I'll take that as a no.
I haven't even watched the video because I can't open it.
I'll take that as a no. All right.
I haven't even got it yet.
I'll get it to you.
Cheers.
All right, what I'd like to do, I'd like at least by the 1st of January to see if we can get our second cycle of training in place. And then I want us to come in on the 20th of January and review what we're doing for the first 4 weeks of the season. Is that okay? So the 20th is the Wednesday before we commence training on the 25th. Hopefully everyone's back from holidays at that stage. Most businesses are back in play at that stage anyway. But I'd like us to come in and hopefully you'll have your second week cycle in place. I've already got the first one for you. But it'll then be a chance for us to look at where we put resources everywhere. You know, where you might want someone to come in and work with your back four, where you might be looking at the attacking third of the park, you might want someone to do it. We have to provide opportunities for our guys who are coming in as assistants. And working with different mentors and such like as well. Okay?
Are we going to allow it to be a little bit fluid in respect to, I know we've got to fit in all the criteria what they've got to learn, but bringing things forward and backwards a bit if we're identifying real footballing problems
on
Saturday.
What I don't want us to do though is go, I need to work on that and just keep figuring back into there.
Yeah.
What I'd like you to do is when you look at your training periodization, if you've got a particular football problem, let's say for example it's dealing with rotating midfielders, okay, and that's not happening, what I'd like you to do is then look at when's your next BPO session, and then maybe use that one, and if that midfield topic is further down the track, bring it back into there so you can look at it and then push the other one further forward.
Yeah, okay? Just move the number.
But I don't want that happening on a week-per-week basis, right? So we're going to try and get in every 4 weeks, so we actually look a little bit ahead of time. I'll be honest, after the first 4 weeks of training, you're going to have a fair idea of where you're at with your sons. You know, you're going to know where a lot of their weaknesses are, you're going to know where we need to be working harder at. Coming back from COVID, Amir, remember we were talking about dealing with transitional moments and such? So that's where we're heading. But if you can, have a bit of a look at the training cycle itself. Think about what you would need if you're working with your team so you can start looking at us heading forward, okay? Did I send everyone an individual copy of that?
Yeah.
Tony, you obviously haven't got one. But I sent the SSP.
Was that the one that you sent something with the video?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, you've got it because you geared it up on Google, didn't you? Yeah, okay. All right. Okay. Just want to have a quick look, and again, I don't want us being here too long. Just want to have a little bit of a look at Sports Session Planner, just to give you a bit of an idea of a resource that is available that we can utilize. I'm happy for you to go on and use that account if you want, okay? But it's a platform that we can actually use to...
Is it about multiple logins, or is it going to bounce someone out?
I don't know. Let's try and see what happens. First and foremost, because what I'm hoping is that my daughter is actually working on some artwork at the moment for Jason's Gaffer program, so he's actually got something similar built into his own system that we'll be able to use, and obviously then that can integrate with what we're doing with video as well. All right, so we'll just go on to Sports Session Plan. Have a look. Has anyone had a look? I think I sent you this information anyway.
Nice photo
next time,
I think I've got that one.
Well, you'll get it. Send the email.
Is it?
Yeah, the bottom of the email. Alright. I'm straight. Let's see what we've got. Oops. Right, this sport session plan, when you get into it, I've used a couple of different ones. Tactics Manager, I've used Soccer Specific. This is another one out of the UK, actually. A lot of professional clubs are using it. There's the sign-in, so we'll just log into that, see where we're at. It actually has its own session library as well, and an event calendar if you choose to use it, but we won't be using that as such because there's only one account set up at this moment in time. If I have to go and find some more money to get accounts for every team, I'm happy to do that. I'm sure we can find the money for it, right? So to give you a bit of an idea, there is a session library of lots of different stuff that's already in place, which are little sessions. If you look on the left-hand side, there's actually a categories menu. So if I was looking at something on counter-reactive pressure, which obviously is based around academy levels, it'll come up with some things that have been loaded into that system by some other coaches, and it'll give credence to who those coaches are as such. So if we looked at that Pro Academy A6D6, is the guy that's actually done it, Nick Ford from Surrey. That's the setup. These diagrams you can actually click and drag to make up your own diagrammatic form as well, and then you just text in what the coaching points and everything are. I was in this afternoon just looking at what I did was I actually went into one of the library sessions. Where are we? I went into one of the library sessions. I was looking at playing out from the back. Or is it? Someone find it for me.
Further on.
Middle.
Bounced it.
Oh, yeah. Because I've only got one eye at the moment. I actually took this session here, where is it? David Todd, that's the one. I used this one, so I've actually brought it up and used that as my template to get started. So what I virtually did was I cloned it. So I just went in there and went clone, and it comes up as the same, exactly all that information there, that's now mine. All right, and then changed a few things. So if you have a look at this one, this started off foundation 20 minutes, foundation phase, obviously based on European or British terminologies as they do. Equipment is included, given some coaching points and such like. And the way he's done it is there's actually three sections to this. So you've got first section there, which might be your introduction. Then you've got the eating the sandwich, where you're actually working on your actual topic itself, and then the game at the end of what it actually instills. Now all I did, when I did that, and I've actually saved it back into the session library, I've actually saved it as a warm-up. And what I did was, so I actually looked at using this and changing everything. I moved players around. As you can see, the arrows were all changed as well. I put goals in there. And I changed the practice itself to a passing practice, which would be the first, if working in game training, the first component of our actual training session, okay? So the passing practice that I've done with this one, basically session aim, goalkeeper at both ends with their own balls, plays into primary players, centre-backs, right-back or left-back for the Reds. So as you can see, we've got a back four set up, which would be the normal team shape. The Blues have their own team. So we've got a midfield three against the midfield three. And then we've got our wide right striker, centre-forward, and left wide striker as well. And then I just put in what they do. So each team actually plays with their own ball. You guys have actually done this. I think I put a session on with this last year where we used it as a passing practice, and it went straight into game training. So you start with each team with the ball, starts from their own goalkeeper. The objective of every player is to have at least one contact before the ball is played to the opposition goalkeeper. All right? Once the team has found the goalkeeper, they reset, start again. So a lot of passing practice into a tactical team shape so that you actually get a chance to do things that are real to the game. Sorry, this all changes as well. You can make it smaller. What's it called? You can actually make it smaller or larger. The actual, when you're actually working the session, it can actually three-dimensionally move around as well. This is pretty alright. So, from there, just got in here, with both teams playing at the same time in opposite directions, there will be interference, because both teams are playing at the same time, they've got their own ball. You don't interfere with the opposition. But there will be interference, because players get in the road. And at the end of the day, what we want to try and do is give players, even in passing practices, something that looks a bit real, where they get a chance to make decisions. So if someone comes and blocks your path, you've got to change your mind about what you're doing, don't you? So from there, we can increase the difficulty. You can make the players play one or two touch. You can increase the difficulty as well by encouraging bounce passes. So for example, I might be playing to Nick, who's playing left back, who bounces it back to me, and I play to Corey, who bounces back to Nick, because that's the sequence that you're actually working in. So you can change things in that way as well. And then the progression from there is work with one ball. One team gets the ball and the other team defends passively. So actually it looks like a game. The actions the players perform, defensive actions that the players perform, attacking actions that the players perform, but no tackling. It is a passing practice at the end of the day. It's a warm-up. So what we've actually asked them to do is they can intercept or they can block passes. If they win the ball back, they go back to their own goalkeeper, they start playing away, they go, and the opposition has to defend. So that was something I took from a session that was already in there and made it my own, changed it over, changed the diagrams, and away we go. So if you look at editing the session, for example, goes into its own little editing tool. On this side here, you can actually change the teams if you want to. You can design your own kit if you choose to. You can put officials in there if you want. Down the left-hand side here, that's all the equipment. These are all click and drag. So you just go and put them where you need them to be. So if you want to put in another football, for example, click and drag and away it goes. If you want to change the lines or you want to have different sorts of lines, wavy runs, ball motions, whatever you choose. And then obviously
you can also put text in these, mate. How do you turn the players around, change the aspect of the players? That's always the hardest thing to put on a player.
So
I choose a different player.
You have to choose a different player, yeah.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So say for example, kit one, actions. So for example, if we're looking at this player here, who we think is a nonce, we'll get rid of that.
Oh, you can't turn him around.
You can't choose to play.
No.
You can turn him around.
You can turn him around.
Well, you can turn around to a degree, but I mean, we can bring in another one who looks a little bit more like he fits that action better.
Ah, okay, you can spin him. Oh,
yeah,
that's,
yeah,
that's good.
Okay. Yeah. Now, you can also move the board.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
So you look at it three-dimensionally.
That's pretty cool.
It is pretty cool. Yeah, so
that's a nice web tool.
So it's not a bad little platform for things like that we're looking at. Okay, so you can have a two-dimensional or a three-dimensional look at it.
You can clone all the objects and everything as well.
Sorry, what's that term?
I said you can clone the objects now as well.
Yes.
So when you've got a clone on there, if you want more.
How much is it? How much is the program?
That's $70.
$70 a year.
Is that what it is?
For an individual, yeah.
Yeah.
It's going to be, with this. This is something that we are, like,
trying
to...
I know what's
going to
happen.
That's what you'll
be
doing.
I'll be halfway through a session and Amir will love me out.
Like,
I'll cry.
Like,
yeah, you know what he's like.
He steals my pictures. He'll steal my sessions.
He loaded all the time. That's what I'm saying.
That'll never
happen. Yeah. And stuff in there. So if that was, like, around the clock, he's going to go down and get, like, licenses and stuff like that. Makes, like, actually reviewing player performance and, like, actually tracking their game time a lot easier. So
that's why I'm keen to go with the program that Powley's working on, because using video is even easier.
Yeah,
and we can track it from that to the video, integrate that into a training session, and away we go. So,
yeah, I understand.
If that's not ready, we'll run with that.
Because the other thing you can do as well, following on from what Nick said, if you can't get your program, setting it up with the club, you've got access to all the other coaches' sessions.
Exactly.
So that's, you've got a huge library for the club itself.
Yeah, it starts building that database and stuff like that. Which
absolutely. And when you think about it, okay, that's three sessions a week. There's, yeah, that's...
I think Graham talked about 90 sessions a month.
But 90, yeah, it is. About 90-odd sessions.
Yeah, yeah.
Per coach.
Yeah, exactly.
Per coach.
And that's all
And sometimes, as I say, like if you were doing this manually, you're rewriting sessions time and time and time again, you're never really keeping them. At least if you've got a platform where it can actually be stored, it gives you something you can refer back to, you can modify it the next time you want to do something along those lines.
You can even clone just parts of sessions as well.
Yep.
So,
because you can add more tabs too, can't you?
Yeah, you can get a...
So for example,
there's one tab here.
So if we had, for example, a passing practice and then the next section was supposed to be a positioning game, you can actually put in a positioning game as well.
Oh, nice. So you can add that into the tabs.
Yep.
Oh, nice. So you do the whole session.
Warm up progression, the skill training, the training game.
Whatever progressions you need to be doing. Yeah. This could be, your game training. And then obviously your training game, and it gives you the, keeps it all nice and neat, keeps it together.
Yeah, that makes it really easy, doesn't it?
That's awesome. And you can have the players and you have the player at the back and the actual team line.
So I see major benefits of this for you guys, you know, and particularly over a longer term, because I know the amount of time it takes to plan. You know, like for every training session you run, it takes you about an hour to an hour and a half to plan. All right. One of our compliances with Football Queensland is the fact we actually have to show them each individual training session for the season. So it's important that we've got a platform that we can utilise to refer back to and provide evidence of all of that. And obviously something that's going to be useful and workable for you guys as well. All right. So as I say, have a go and see if you're able to use my licence anyway, if you haven't already got your own. And just see what you come up with. Trial it out, see how it goes.
Do they have a club-based subscription model on that?
Yeah, they do.
They do, yeah.
They do. They've sent me a deal for the whole club, whole of club, which was for about 30 different licences. It worked out to about $3,500. So,
But that's where, like Nick was saying, you can add in entire squads.
Yeah.
So you can do the reviews on the games, reviews on your trainings.
Oh, okay, we do the club
game.
Okay.
Game time, training time.
Yeah, I had one years ago who did all that and they went broke, unfortunately.
I thought we might have bought them out.
Now, they were Brazilian, actually.
Were they?
It was a Brazilian one. It was really good as well. And they did all that as well. I did all the club management. So, yeah.
Now, can you send us a PDF?
Yeah, you can. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes,
but I imagine you could just take an iPad if you want, couldn't you?
That's what I'm saying.
Well, with they've just changed it to as a beta, I think, because they used to use Flash Player on it.
Yeah.
And they've changed it so that now you can use it on your, you can bring it up on your phone. You can actually design it on your phone.
Yeah. You can actually do
iPad,
you can do animation with it as well. But when you're timing everything for animation, it's really, really time conscious.
Yeah, I've tried before. The one I used before had all the animation in there. It was nice, but it was really hard to get right because the players have been runs a long time.
Yeah. Just like when you're coaching them.
Just running down the under 14.
Bad first touches.
Unbelievable.
So, okay, so you're comfortable with that? So you know that's there?
Where's my niece?
Your what?
Okay. So, sports session plan, there's the information for you anyway. I'll send this to you tomorrow, anyhow, just as a PDF, so that's all right. Obviously, as far as coaches are concerned, is anyone doing the skills training course next week at all?
No.
You're doing that once, yeah? But how are you?
Monday,
Wednesday? Next week? Why not?
So I'm doing the steel license.
Yeah, that's fine.
Isn't it like kind of like
C1? Yeah, it's a bit of a snapshot. Have you started the C license yet?
No, I'm doing it in January.
Well, I'd like you, if you could make yourself available to do the skills training, it'll help you on the C license. Because what it'll do, it'll provide you a little bit of a snapshot of things that you'll be doing on the C license that might actually help it make more sense to you, if you get where I'm at.
Okay.
But if you can register, you have to pay for it. The club will pay you back at the completion of it, which will be on Wednesday when you finish. So,
Two sessions, Monday and Wednesday night.
Yeah.
So you're doing C youth, is it? You're doing C youth? Or
yeah.
Senior, are you youth? Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. So when's your senior?
No, yeah, but I'm only doing part two.
Yeah.
Because I've done part one twice. When I did the youth. So it's, but I think it's the last two weekends of November, December.
Okay.
That's like script.
Cool. All right, now I've got most people's contact details here, so I'll make them available, because obviously as we progress, you're going to need to be interacting with each other, because some coaches will be working with different teams from time to time. I'm actually going to release on the weekend when we do the induction on Sunday morning. I'm going to show all the parents how our coaching system actually looks like and announce all of you guys. So if I haven't got a photograph of you, I need to get one tonight before you leave. But that'll at least give you some information where you can contact everyone. And from there, I think we're just about cooked. Fingers crossed. Yes, we are. Right. One thing I would like you to think about, and when we're working with the kids and we send the kids out on the park, one thing I don't like is those little huddles that we have before the game. Whether I like it or not, it seems to be in. What I'd like us to try and do is take a little bit more pride in the fact of who we are. So instead of the kids going 1, 2, 3 Hawks, I'd actually like us to encourage them to go, we are Hawks, and just get that message across the board to everyone. I'd like everyone to start thinking along those lines. We are Hawks, not 1, 2, 3 Hawks. It just sounds like you're throwing it out there. So that's going to come up again on the weekend. We're going to remind people to take some ownership on the club as an entity as such as well. The for those who want to tune in, the induction on the weekend, the SAP induction is at 11 o'clock. The NPL induction is at 9 o'clock. So obviously we're having to do it online this time as opposed to where we had the Great Hall at Churchy last year. So what I've tried to do, because we can't have as much interaction with everyone as we did on the day there, I've tried to incorporate a fair bit of video and little things that have some subliminal messages to give the players a little bit of provocative thought, I'm hoping.
Is that Saturday?
That's on Saturday. Sorry, Sunday?
Sunday.
Sunday this week. So, for example, little clips like this will come up. On this screen. Hang on a sec. Oh, hang on. You won't hear anything.
Same choice. That is where the Richmond lose 4-1. Andy Brightspot being the defensive player, Sam Bobby Sam.
Andy Brightspot. Felt me would have been 4-0, you miserable.
And a meal on this consolation goal. Jamie Todd, meaning to himself.
Thank you.
Jamie. Look with.
Ted Lasso.
Yeah.
What a guy.
I haven't known you that long. I can honestly say you were the best half in that game. Oh. I see. You are truly brave in everything you do. That one thing, and it's a cross. Jamie, I think you might be so sure that you're one thing. But sometimes you feel kind of better than that. Just figure out some way from that me to us. It's not linked to you. The heck of a goal out there. Thanks.
So I've thrown a couple of those in. So I hope that makes sense to some people when we're trying to get some little messages across to them. This is another one, just so you...
Are they all Ted Lasso?
Trying my best to get them all Ted Lasso.
That's jokes.
So, and this is one other. One of those players here.
Yeah.
Hello.
Steve.
So I'd like to think that there's some really subliminal messages in there, so that's going to be, some of those things will be in the thing as well, so that's where we're at. Anyway, guys, thanks very much for coming in tonight, appreciate the time. Anything anyone needs to bring to the table? Corey, you should get out of here while your migraine's killing you. How you going, Rob?
Oh, you need to get a photo anyway.
Oh, got to get a photo, that's right. My apologies. But anything else comes to mind, anything you guys might need? Hopefully over the Christmas break I'll have all the equipment and everything sorted so we're ready to go. And then from here, we're off and running.
So we start training end of January?
25th of January.
Pre-season friendlies?
The only one that I've got booked in so far is against Redlands on the 13th of February. So far. Just thought we'd throw these two back in there. So.
Both coaching against their own
team. That's it.
Outstanding.
Just a rub of his soul.
So
hopefully it's out there as well.
It is.
Oh shit.
So we've got three ex-Redland guys here now.
Yeah, Johnny as well.
So, but, hey, all the very best over Christmas, guys. Hope you have a great time. Enjoy your time off. What I will say though. And I'll send some information anyway. I'd like you at some stage to make contact with your players over the Christmas break. As I said to you last week, the kids coming back from Christmas last year were woeful. Fitness-wise, attitude-wise, speed, reaction, the whole shebang. It was like a starting point again. And yet, when we came away from COVID, they came back, they were actually a bit better prepared because we'd actually kept in contact. Obviously, I think they found the fact that they needed to do something during that period as well, but they got off their backsides and followed some home training work that was set for them, communicated with each other a little bit more often, challenged each other more, and I think that's a very important thing we need to be doing over the Christmas break. All right, so if we can...
Do we have the same access to what that app you use, Lee, that team app?
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's a great way of getting all the kids talking through that team app.
Yeah, well, Lee's just gone through that at the moment, or carriers.
Yeah, I've got. I'll get one loaded on. That's about.
Yeah,
new kids attending.
So we normally use TeamApp as the main communication tool. Anyway, so that'd be good. But apart from that, everyone, hope you have a great Christmas. Enjoy yourselves, not too much, because if you have more of a good time than me, I'll be very disappointed. And we will see you on the 21st when we get back in business, and I'll send you some information from tonight as well. Really, thank you very much for your time, guys. Appreciate it, and we shall see you soon. Who am I going to get photographs of?
Arigato.
Alexio.
Steve.
Crushed it.
Photograph of Steve.